Thank you, thank you. Maybe I need to get a little bit closer. Welcome to my talk. I'm glad and surprised so many showed up, especially since the last one on this track. This is my first talk in US, first talk in English, so please bear with me. This talk is named All Your Badges Belong to Us, and my name is John Andre Bjørkaug. I'm Norwegian, working as a penetration tester for a Norwegian company called NetSecurity. I'm originally educated as an electronic engineer with specialization in wireless systems and telecommunication. But it's much more fun to break stuff than building stuff, therefore I do penetration testing instead of engineering. I've been doing penetration testing for 16 years, focusing on everything from internal testing, web apps, physical testing, social engineering, and so on. Small disclaimer. Most of the stuff in this presentation is not new. Most of it is already known, but it's so stupid and everyone should know, therefore I'm giving this talk. Nothing of what I say represents my company. It is my meanings and feelings. PACS, P-A-C-S. Does anyone know what that acronym stands for? No one? Close. Proximity Access Control System. Most, I hope, have seen readers like this and have cards like this. If you haven't seen anything like this before, you should go out from the rock you're hiding under. I made this sketch to try to explain how an access control system is built. Starting on the right for you. You have the token, the badge, which communicates with a reader, either on HF 13.56 MHz or 125 kHz, LF. When you take your card against the reader, there is a RF signal charging a capacitor in the token, acting like a battery, giving power to the microcontroller, which again makes the communication between the reader and the token possible. The reader communicates either wireless or wired through protocols like VGAN or OSDP to a controller. The controller has the entire user database, and the controller is the one doing the authentication. The controller also communicates with the door and opens the doors if the token is valid. The controller talks to a server, which has the user interface, the user database, and the configuration. The server also in many cases acts like a client. It's where the software is installed and all the users added to the system. And in many cases, this is a standalone system, not connected to the local network. It's not connected to anything in many cases, except maybe internet, because the vendor needs to have access via TeamViewer to do configuration. In some other cases, you might have the same over here, but the server, and you have several clients with the application running on it, and the server and the clients might be joined to a domain. So if an adversary is able to compromise the domain, he also have compromised the entire access control system, which I have done in several penetration tests. We were able to dump the entire database and create our own cards. I mentioned earlier that you have HF and LF tokens, high frequency and low frequency. So I made this slide trying to explain the different technologies used and also saying which of the tokens are possible to clone easy and which is considered secure. Myfri Classic, I guess many of you have heard about Myfri Classic tokens, Myfri Classic cards. NTAG, HID, iClass, and iClass Elite is really easy to copy, to clone. Myfair Ultralight, Myfair Deathfire EV1 is considered also possible to clone, but it's a bit harder. And the green ones, Deathfire EV2 and EV3 is considered quite secure. EV3 is what is recommended if you're going to have a Myfair Classic, Myfair installation. And the low frequency cards, you have like HIDProx, EM, AVID, Indale, EOProx, EMR in Viking, and a bunch of others. They have no security. There is a few exceptions. Someone has tried to make some password thing there, but no one is using it. So if you have any LF cards, it's really easy to clone them. My Fair Classic. A little bit more details on them. And Per, you asked us to have some kittens, if there are some slides with just information someone might know, so I included some ChatGPT-generated kittens. The My Fair Classic is an invention from the mid-90s, so it's not so old. Well, maybe it's getting old, but yeah. It was originally Philips, the Dutch company who made the My Fair Classic. Myfair was later turned into, moved over to a company called NXP Semiconductors in 2006. It was a proprietary encryption, so it should be really secure, or maybe not. In 2007-2008, Karsten Nohl, a really famous security researcher from Netherlands, together with some other people, were able to crack the Myfair Classic algorithm. In 2011, there was an update with backward compatibility that was cracked in 2015. In 2015, NXP also recommends that no one should use My Fair Classic afterwards. The picture you can see here I took during a penetration test last year, and that was a system installed in July last year using My Fair Classic, which was recommended in 2015 never to be used anymore. So you should use more secure cards, like for example DESFire EV3. This installation also uses only the UID on the card, which I will come back to later. More details on the My Fair Classic. The data on those cards are divided into 16 sectors. There's four blocks on each sector, and the first block or the first sector has the UID and some other information hard-coded. So it's not possible to change the UID on a regular card. And all sectors has its own encryption keys, two keys, one A and one B key. Both of them are 6 byte long. If one of these keys are known, there are some attacks called nested and hard-nested attack, which makes it possible to get all the other keys on the card. And on many, many, many systems, there is at least one default keys, which in many cases is FFFFFFFFFF, which is the default encryption keys. So if, for example, only one sector is used and it's password protected, but all the other sector has the default FFFFFFFFFF, it is possible using nested or hard-nested attack to crack it. Default keys. No one uses default keys or default passwords anymore, Per?
Nobody.
No?
Absolutely nobody.
Yeah, that's good to hear. In 2014, I worked for a company in Norway. I got my access card to the to the office. I had a reader, ACR 122, if anyone has a reader like that, really good reader. I cracked the keys on my card because I was curious. I hadn't done any work with RFID before, so I just wanted to try it out. Cracked the keys, put those keys into my Android phone with the app My Fair Classic tool, and just to show my colleagues, it's so easy to copy the cards. Maybe we should talk to the people who owns the building and maybe make them change the system or something. But a couple of weeks later, I was doing an internal penetration test for a customer of mine. And during lunch, I saw that he had this card hanging around his neck, and we started to talk about access control, and I was just curious, can I just try to read your card to see what kind of technology is used? And to my surprise, I was able to dump his card, and I didn't understand why until I saw that I accidentally chose the dictionary with the keys from where I worked. So it turned out that I was able to dump his card from a totally different company, totally different building, using the keys from my office. So I started to do some research, talked to people I knew, found some people who had the same access control system. We tried to dump those cards too, and we found out that all cards were using the same keys. All the systems had the same A and B key. And I talked to the vendor, And they said, yeah, they use the default keys for all installations. It's easy. System came hard-coded with them, and it was impossible to have control of different keys for all their customers. Therefore, they use the default keys. Now, in 2024, I still see these keys used on new systems. And the funny thing is that if you take that key and decode it as ASCII, it is the name of the vendor.
What's the vendor's name?
Will this be on YouTube? Actually, I had the name of the vendor here, but when I realized that this was going on YouTube, I removed it.
Yeah.
But here, I have a vendor. The only reason I have the vendor here is that this is a screenshot taken from the Proxmark default dictionary. Salto is a company who makes access control system, of course, and they use both on offices, on hotels, and all over. And they have two different systems for hotels and like regular office buildings, but they use the same keys on everything. So if you stay at a hotel having a system from Salto, you can take the keys from that system and you can use the same keys at the office building. And it's only this is the A key and that's the B key found in the default dictionary. So it's really easy to dump. And in Norway at least, I've seen this, it might be one of the most used access control systems. And interesting thing that when the customer buys an access control system, it gets the documentation. The encryption keys is not mentioned in the documentation, and that is for sure not mentioned that it is a default keys that is used. So it should be easy to change these keys. As I said earlier, the vendor said like, how should we store the different keys for all customers? It's not possible for them, apparently. But there exist some databases for secure storage, password managers. You could have used something that's as simple as Bitwarden for saving the keys for different companies. Yeah, you should never use default keys. You should never use the same keys on other customers. 2 weeks ago, approximately, on the 25th of July, Per sent me this article in Ars Technica about the default keys. And there was an article about secure boot using default keys on many models from the large vendors of laptops, like computers, like Lenovo, HP, Dell, and so on. And in this article, there was guy who was interviewed tried to make a metaphor and compare the secure boot to a door lock system to make it more understandable, I guess. But that quote actually fits quite well with what I'm describing in this presentation. Imagine all the people in an apartment building have the same front door lock and key. If anyone loses the key, it could be a problem for the entire building. But what if things are even worse and other buildings have the same lock and the keys? That's what we have when we have these default keys and the same keys used all over for the access control systems. So, story time. As I said, I'm doing penetration testing. I'm doing a lot of physical penetration testing. So here's a story about one physical pen test I did a while back for a large power company in Scandinavia. It was a physical penetration test, and the goal was getting physical access to the headquarters. To prove that we could access the network, show access to sensitive areas, and place a dummy bomb on a central location. So everything from proving that we had network access to showing that we could blow up the building. So we'll skip all the recon and the social engineering part, but basically we were able to tailgate into a temporary office building next to the headquarters. It was some barracks that was temporarily installed. There we found two access cards just laying around on a desk, very shiny and new, and it turned out that they didn't work because the employees hadn't started yet. When we tested the cards in front of some readers, it only blinked red, so they didn't have access. But we found out that these cards were using MIFARE Classic EV1, and several of the sectors had the encryption keys FFFFFFF. Never mind how many FFFs. which is the default keys, as mentioned before. Using the nested attack, we were able to crack all the other keys. It turned out there were one sector on the card that had data. The data looked like this. Turned out this is ASCII. We decoded it as ASCII, and we got this string for one card and this string for another card. Well, we didn't get the X's and the Y's though. The X's turned out to be the site ID, and the Y's turned out to be the user ID. And at the end, you had a checksum. In the beginning, you have some sort of ID. You know, say so much more about that ID that might be possible to know the vendor from that string, so don't Google it. And you have this semicolon, which is interesting because on old magnetic cards, or magnetic stripe cards, semicolon was used to divide the fields. It was a separator. So it looks like this MIFRA classic card is actually emulating a magnetic card, which was interesting. And this was a rather old system, but it's still used on a lot of places. I've seen those readers many, many places. They had both old readers and new readers for backward compatibility. As mentioned, this was the data. This is some kind of ID. X's are site ID, Y's are user ID, and the ZZZ at the end is the checksum. So, just what happens if we take those user IDs and you try to increment them and decrement them and see do we get any other valid cards? So we tried to change the ID to something else, swipe the card, didn't work. Then we started to think about what if we actually have a valid ID, but the CRC or checksum thingy at the end is not valid. So we tried to find a method to calculate the CRC. A colleague of mine was sitting with that, just hammering away with CyberChef and different methods for trying to find that CRC. But I didn't have the patience. It shouldn't be that difficult. We can't sit here all day in the car trying to find what CRC method is used. So I'm a big fan of KISS, like keep it simple, stupid. So the difference between those two cards that we had was only half a byte. So I changed ID, started checksum 0 and incremented. On the second try, I got a green light on the reader. The card was valid, but I was asked for a PIN. So we used some hours on this. We were able to make valid cards, but that company used PIN all day, which not many uses. But so this is valuable information if we are able to, if you're doing a test for a customer having the same system, which do not use PIN. So instead of copying the card and walking in with that, we had just tailgated in instead and got access to some very critical areas in that building. But it was a very interesting case and we learned a lot from it. So a little bit more about MIFRA Classic and MIFRA. Whoa, time. In the EU, there's a lot of ASA Abloy Wing cards. That's MIFRA Ultralight. If you have the old firmware on the readers, there is no password. You can just dump the card using, for example, a Flipper. Flipper Zero, which everyone knows what is, I guess. If you have a new firmware on the readers, there's a password. So you have to dump the parts of the cards that you can dump without the password. Then you have to go to the reader to get the password, and then you can dump the rest. We also have some MIFRA Classic, as mentioned before with the Salto. But here in the US, this summer, I had a road trip from New York to LA. I stayed at 9 hotels across the US, all had MIFRA Classic. And out of those 9, 8 of them, I was able to crack the and dump the cards using my Flipper or my Proxmark with default dictionaries and the nested attack. So just in case someone hasn't seen a hotel card being copied with a Flipper, everyone has seen that on YouTube now, I guess, but just in case. This is my hotel here in Vegas now. Just take 2 seconds to copy the card, emulate it on the door, and I'm in. But that's another video. But as I said, I'm doing a lot of physical testing. I'm very eager in doing other things than copying the cards, because it's much more easy to just attack physically on the doors in many cases. Like, for example, this. That's a hotel in Norway. So why bother with all the technology when you can just use a simple shim to open the door? So, but encrypted data. I mentioned earlier that some systems only uses the UID. When the UID only is used, there is no encrypted data. Both on Wi-Fi Classic and Wi-Fi Deathfire, and of course the LF cards, the UID can be sniffed super fast, and you can use like equipment and a larger antennas, so you can read it for like a meter, maybe more if you have some really specialized equipment. There's a large number of vendors and a large number of installations that have only the UID. And there's a lot of vendors that support everything else. It supports encrypted data, it supports Deathfire, it supports a lot of secure technologies, but they only use the UID. And I think that's the reason for that is that it's easy to configure for them. They don't have to manage those keys. They just use the UID. And this is a screenshot for the application for a large vendor of access control system used a lot in Scandinavia. And as you can see, this is the default types of cards that you can use. None here mentioned encrypted sectors. Here you have a CSN card serial number, HIDPROX, that's only the ID, 125 kilohertz card, PROX, digits, EM, only UID, Deathfire, CSN. Yeah. And most installations I see from this vendor has only the UID. I will not say the name, but ask me afterwards. One more story. This was a large international research organization. Again, we had a physical penetration test, and the goal was to get in and get access to most areas. We went in at the end of the day. When someone was going out, we just went in and started to check all the available spaces in the building. And we found the janitor's office unlocked in a hallway that we were able to access. In that office, we found a locked cabinet. When we looked at the cabinet, it was locked, turned around, we found this. A box with a lot of old keys and old locks. Started to dig around in that, and we found the key for the cabinet. Within the cabinet, there was a shitload of keys and cards, including ID cards for security personnel. But the most interesting card that we found was the card for the son of the janitor, because apparently he had some summer job or something there. So he copied that card together with some other ones, started to go around the building, but yeah, they needed a PIN at night, so we were not able to get into any areas. But we came back the day after. We were two. I only had one card with me, one blank card. So I copied the data onto that card, gave it to my colleague, he went in. But after we had been in for a while, I was getting restless in my car sitting outside. I wanted to go in too. It was boring just to sit there. This was in the middle of the winter in Norway and it was cold. So I just took my flipper, emulating the card, walking by the security guard, like almost like this on the picture here, with my flipper in hand. I'm sure the guard had seen it, but it didn't react. And I was in. But why is so much crap still used? Can anyone answer to that? Yep. Budgets. Yep, it's cheap. There exist billions of badges already, and the vendors are lazy. Why should they learn anything new when they can just earn the same amount of money or even more doing what they have done for a lot of years? And in many cases, I think that the security requirements are not specified good enough in the request for proposal. There's much focus on the price And the customers, often they trust the sellers. They're stupid as they are, they trust the salesperson who say that this is a secure system. I once asked an installation company why they still use these cards. Why do you still use this old protocols? Why do you still use only the UID? And his answer was, we just install it and make it work. We don't know anything about the protocols. That was kind of scary. So, can you upgrade access control system? If it's old enough, you have to replace all the readers, the controllers, the server, everything. It will be really expensive. Maybe like 100K, several hundred K's, depending on the size of the company, of course. If it's relatively new, the hardware in many cases support new technologies. But as I mentioned before, the people installing it, they use the old technologies because that's what they know. If it's relatively new, it is possible to only replace the badges and recode the badges and do some configuration changes on the system. The badges are often quite expensive. They shouldn't be because they're really cheap to produce, but the providers takes a lot for them anyway. I found a video on YouTube from HID, the large American manufacturer of access control systems, showing how they could reprogram, how they could upgrade the firmware on a reader. So they had, I think in this process, they had five different cards containing the firmware for the reader, and they had to set the reader in a special upgrade mode, and it took like 5 minutes to upgrade one reader. It placed one card on the reader, rebooted the reader when it started to blink the correct sequence of color, replaced it, put in a new card. It's like you're installing a game with floppy disks in 95. So the 5 minutes plus for one reader, it is possible to upgrade some of the readers using a mobile app, but it also take many minutes. So if you have a large installation with like several hundred readers, it will take a lot of time to upgrade the software. But it's a fun little clip. If anyone, just Google HID reader upgrade or something. So the cards are in many cases very easy to clone. So use PIN all day on all places. That's the point from all the slides I had before. Roles. In most cases, not all cards have the same access, of course. How can that be misused? For example, in many cases you have a master card, a card that have access to everything. For example, the janitor has cards like that. Some places I've seen that you have seen key boxes like this, I guess. How easy is it to open a box like this? Have anyone tried? I was able to teach my daughter in 5 minutes. She was 11 years old. She used 5 minutes to learn how to open boxes like this. And inside these boxes, you can find access cards with the master role without PIN, because in emergency, you don't want to use the PIN because it takes more time. So that's kind of scary. And guest cards, they can be upgraded in many cases. For example, if you remember back when I was talking about this going from invalid to a valid card, we just changed the ID. So if you have a guest card, you can try to increment or decrement from the ID on the card and maybe get more access than you should. So cards in the same number series have more access. And what about PIN codes? What do you think is the most used PIN code in this place? 1? What digit is that? That? What about that? Yeah, 2580. We were doing another penetration test, physical test, and I saw this outside, took a photo of it. thought it was kind of funny. And later we were able to get inside, getting some cards from some drawers in there. And we tried those cards on some internal doors, and we were asked for a pin. And like, what can the pin be? And I remembered this and said 2580, yeah. Turned out that was the pin code on all the cards for every employee on that facility. More about pin codes. One large vendor, I asked them, how do you store your pin codes in a database? They were encrypted, but they wouldn't say how. They were not allowed to say how. This is a dump from the database. This is the encrypted or encoded or some obscured in some way. So if anyone wants to try to help it find out how these are obscured, please shout out. There's another system. When you do an export of the entire database, the pin code is in clear text. Pin in clear text. Another large vendor. Another one. I mentioned the name. This was during a penetration test. We were able to compromise the database server on this access control system because I found the server. It had Lenel in its name, and I found the. Actually, a couple of weeks before, I read the technical manual for that exact system, just out of random. And I remember, there's a default password here. And I found that manual again, and then just, I can't be using the same default password everywhere, but just wanted to try with the password security, with a one instead of I and a hash at the end. And I was able to get system on that box because, of course, the database was running a system. Starting to browse around the system, dumping the database, I found out that the pin code was actually encrypted in the database. But on another part of the disk, we found an export, a CSV file, with all the card numbers, the names, the role, the pin codes in clear text and everything. So we could just, and they only used the UID, of course, which was in that CSV file. So we can just create our own cards and we knew the pin code for everyone. So here's a tried, you won't see so much here. It's, I tried to anonymize, I'll scrabble most of it, but it's a pin code at the end. And the dump was, how much did I say? 4,000 or 5,000 users. Replay attacks. Has anyone heard anything about replay attacks on access control systems? So I started off, if you remember the sketch I had, the cards at the right, the next step was the controller, and between the controller and the, between the reader and the controller, there is some protocols called VGAN and OSTP and so on. Many of those is possible to replay. VGAN, you have some, you even use RS-232 or some other serial protocols, OSTP, the reader, communicates with the controller, and the controller opens the door if it's a valid card, as I mentioned earlier. But what if you're able to connect something here, and when the card is swiped, you're able to record that data, and afterwards you can replay it, because these are not encrypted. So, but how do you get access to that cable? Here's some card readers that I've seen on some tests. This is one from Solid Card or Assa Abloy. And on the bottom, you have this tubular key. Is anyone into lockpicking? Is it hard to open locks like this? It's possible to open them with just a piece of paper or a Bic pen. And this one is even easier. You can just screw it up with a Phillips screwdriver. When inside, there in many cases there is a tamper switch, but we have removed several of these. I'll open many of these, but never gotten any alarm. For some reason. And in some cases, you don't even need to open the reader. Don't need to trigger the tamper switch because the cables are available on other places. ESP key, anyone heard about that? That's a device based on the ESP32. which you can connect and do the replay attack. Red Team Tools by Divent Olaf and Babak, and guys that you might have known from DEFCON. They sell this at their store. It is also open source, so it is possible to build it yourself. It's quite complicated, but you can. Just a short demo, see if this works. I made a kit to try to show how it's done. So then I swiped on the invalid card, it was red, valid card. And then you can connect to that ESP key with your phone. And you can replay, and as you can see, it lights up green. So if anyone wants to build a kit like the ones shown in the movie, the video, I put it up on GitHub, the schematics for it. But I think that the ESP key is really good, but it's expensive. It costs $79, and it's very complicated to make yourself, even if you have access to the schematics. And also it uses, to connect to it with your phone, it has an AP access point. So you can connect to it via Wi-Fi, but if you use, for example, an iPhone, connect to it via Wi-Fi, the phone often gets screwed up because it doesn't have internet access, and it got confused because it's connected to a Wi-Fi but doesn't have internet access. So I didn't like that, so I made my own project just to simplify everything. This is the entire schematics. It has codename VESP key by the at the moment, because it's, instead of Wi-Fi, it connects via Bluetooth low energy. And it has really few parts, just one ESP32, DC-DC converter, a couple of resistors, a couple of transistors, and a prototype board, and you can build it. If anyone wants to help me finish the code, please shout out. The hardware design is finished, but the code needs some tuning. I'm no coder. At the moment, it looks like this. If you want to do some research on RFID and access control systems, there's some tools that you need. Proxmark Mark III, I guess many of you have heard about that. This is a Proxmark III with a Blue Shark Bluetooth module on top with a battery. Everyone that do RFID need a Proxmark. If you have an Android phone, you can install the application Wi-Fi Classic Toolkit, which is also very, very handy to have. And some China stuff. This is a really cheap China card cloner. I think it costs like $10, $15. It also have options to crack encrypted cards. But then you need to connect to it, to connect the PC to it, and you need to install some shady Chinese software, so I never tried it. But it's really easy to use to copy the ID on all sorts of cards. Chameleon Ultra is really good. So if you need some tips on what equipment you need, just shout out. And of course, everyone knows this. How many does have a flipper here? Yeah, that's good to see. And for the rest of you, buy one, it's fun. A couple of links to where you can buy some stuff. Lab 401 is really good, especially if you live in Europe. Red Team Tools, M-Toolsec. But did you think it was bad until now? Let's make it a bit more worse. Let's see, your access control system. You will never expose that on the internet, will you? Do you think anyone will? During the making of this presentation, I just thought it would be fun to just check out Shodan to see if I found some access control systems there. And actually, I found three different vendors, which I knew very well from Norway. And I found several hundred access control systems only from those three vendors exposed to internet. So vendor number one, Zalto. I found, you can see in the banner information, is it blurry? It's Salto, and here's a RDP session in, for a Salto server. And also there's some some web interface logons to the Salto access control system. Another one, Lenel, which I talked about earlier. Actually, I found several in the US. Access to the management interface, which might have default password, I don't know. And some of them are running the database too, which I mentioned earlier, with a default password. So maybe some of the ones you can find on Shodan has a default password. I don't know. One more vendor, Assa Abloy. Many in Norway and Sweden having exposed the admin interface. And for Assa Abloy, when you first log on to your installation, the default username is master, and you have to change the password on the first login. But way too many change the password to master, because it's easy, master, master. And since these are exposed on the internet, what could possibly go wrong? I actually found a way of brute forcing the... I made a tool for password spraying against these Assa Abloy boxes, but I will not say so much more about that. So, that's it. Any questions?
Questions for John.
So, I think you had mentioned about 9 or 10 different technologies, right, in the beginning of the talk.
Yeah.
How do you approach figuring out which technology you're up against when you go into a pen test?
If you can see the reader on Google Maps or something, Google Street View, you can maybe identify the vendor of the system, and from that you can see what kind of cards is supported by that type. And if you're able to get access to one card, you can identify the technology by using a Proxmark, for example, or a phone. And also to see if it's, see if I have a picture. You can easily find out if it's communicating over, if it's a HIF or LF card, using, for example, this field detector. This will have two LEDs. One will blink if it's 13.56 megahertz, and one will blink if it's 125 kilohertz. It has two antennas tuned to the two different frequencies, so you can easily identify that. Those are really handy to have. There are some open source project too on this. And I also was a guy here at B-Side who had this, his business card had this field detector built in.
Okay.
Any questions?
We have to cut it off there. This was the last talk at the Passwords Contract, and now there will be closing ceremonies in the middle ground, big room. And then, of course, there's the famous pool party starting at 10 in the evening, and then some. So thank you all for coming along. John, you're also speaking at DEF CON Village something?
No.
But you will be there.
Yeah, and I will be volunteer at the Red Team Village.
Red Team Village. So you can also find him there and talk to him there as well. So again, another round of applause for John.